Okay, ladies, gentlemen, welcome to Kalaari Lounge. I'm glad to see such a large turnout. This event we conduct, we try to do it every year, but it's happening every other year. And this is primarily meant to bring the Kalaari team, the extended Kalaari family, which includes our portfolio companies, and bring the larger entrepreneurial ecosystem that includes our peer firms, other private equity firms, the law firms, banks, everyone here, to interact with our companies, meet each other, and just enjoy the occasion. It's supposed to be an informal event. We're not going to bore you with a lot of speeches and shows, etc. We only have one key real speaker here, and I can assure you, you'll enjoy. Not because he's from my hometown, but you'll really enjoy hearing him out. But to begin with, I would like to make a few introductions. I'll try and keep this brief. As you might have noticed from the press release this morning and a few news stories, we've expanded our team, and we've been building towards this for a few months now, and we're really glad to add some top-notch names to our team. I would like to introduce them, and I'm sure most of you know them, but anyway, I'll ask them to come say hello to you as well. So I'll begin with Mr. Ravi Venkatesan, and most of you know him as a great leader. He has built some great companies in India, and he's thought of as a great thought leader in India. So I'll briefly give his background for the people that who don't know him. I'm sure that very few of you. Ravi is the founder chairman of Social Venture Partners India. He serves on the boards of Rockefeller Foundation, Infosys, and Strand Life Sciences. Ravi is also the author of an acclaimed book, Conquering the Chaos, Win in India, Win Everywhere. It's very, very similar to, if you can drive in India, you can drive everywhere. Published by Harvard Business Review, so you should get that book, it's a great book. Prior to this, most of you know him as chairman of Microsoft India between 2004 and 2011. Ravi helped build India into Microsoft's second largest presence in the world, and one of its fastest growing markets. Ravi has begun mentoring our companies already, and we're really excited to have Ravi here. I know Ravi is hiding somewhere. He didn't want to really come up here and say anything, but Ravi, could you please come here? Please welcome me. Welcome Ravi to the stage, please. You're here.
Just a few minutes. Yeah, thanks a lot. Yeah, I hate being put on the spot, but I guess today I have no choice. But I'm delighted to be here. There are moments in time when, you know, there are profound changes, and this is one of them. I was explaining to Vani that I've torn myself away in the midst of a shift of residence. But professionally also, this is a time of significant change. Just a few weeks ago, this is something that perhaps you didn't know, I joined the government, and I've got the chance to lead a wonderful 107-year-old institution called the Bank of Baroda. At the other extreme, I'm thrilled to be joining Kalaari, working with incredibly young companies, incredibly young entrepreneurs. And you know, when Vani and I discussed what it is that I could do, the best way I could contribute, I said the best way I could probably do, sort of make some difference, is pass on a little bit of what I've learned about leadership and building businesses to the next generation of entrepreneurs. So she's helped me identify 9 young entrepreneurs with great promise who I'm beginning to work with. And yeah, this is one of the most interesting and energizing parts of my professional life right now. And I look forward to getting to meet many more of you as I work with Kalaari. So thanks, Vani. Thanks, Rajesh.
Thank you, Ravi. And by the way, Ravi is joining us on the advisory team for Kalaari Capital. And as you might have known this, for the last 6 months, Mr. Ratan Tata has been part of our advisory team, and Ravi joins the team. And I'm going to introduce the third member of the team, which is Mr. Ram Gupta. Ram has already joined us for a few months now, and he's been working very actively with a few of our companies. He has already joined a couple of the boards of our companies. And Ravi, Ram has years of experience, and we're really looking forward to Ram contributing a great deal to our portfolio. And for a few of you who don't know Ram, Ram is a tech veteran from Silicon Valley, and Ram currently serves on the boards of Progress Software, S1 Corporation, Yodlee, among many other boards. Ram brings over 20 years of strategy and execution expertise at global technology companies. Previously, Ram was the president and CEO of Cast Iron Systems. Before that, he was executive vice president at PeopleSoft, where he was instrumental in taking the company from primarily an HR applications vendor in the US to the second largest vendor of application suites worldwide. Ram was also the executive in charge of the company's $1.8 billion acquisition of JD Edwards. That set off the consolidation trend in the ERP industry. I'm sure all of you are familiar with that consolidation trend. I think there are only two companies standing now. In addition to helping our companies on product marketing and strategy, he will be a conduit to our entrepreneurs to the Valley, which we sorely need his help in helping our companies finding new markets, finding new investors. And please join me in welcoming Ram to the Kalaari team. Ram.
Thank you. Good evening. Good evening. Good evening. Thank you. I don't have a whole lot to say. I just wanted to make one observation. So spend about 20 years in the Valley now, and shuttle now a little bit here and there. First of all, fortunate to work with Vani and rest of the Kalaari team. And today, I was telling a story that in 2005, Vani and I were hanging out at a hole in the wall restaurant in Santa Clara, and trying to figure out what to do next. She had just come off her last startup. I had just come off of my startup. And before I knew, I was at her house for a going away party to come to India and start a venture fund. And you went like, well, who does that? Why would somebody do that? And it's incredible what has been accomplished in the last 10 years. She came out here, she built a team, she built a company, and the caliber of people she's collected it. And now Kalaari is the top three venture funds in the country. It's just incredible, and most of you have gotten the benefit of that. So thank you, Vani, for... I'm speechless, exactly. I'm proud. I'm very proud that she considers me her friend. So there you have it. The observation I have is that pound for pound, I spent so much time with the entrepreneurs in the Valley, and now I spent some time with the entrepreneurs here. Pound for pound, you guys are twice as good as the Valley entrepreneurs. So big round of applause to you guys. You guys are twice as good. And I'm just fortunate that you've given me a chance to work with you. I'm there for you. Anything and everything I can do, I will do. Just reach out to me. Thank you.
Looks like pound for pound, the Valley entrepreneurs are very heavy, Ram. Thank you, Ram. I have a couple of additional announcements to make. In addition to expanding the advisory team at Kalaari, we've also expanded our investment team. So we've added two new partners to the team, and I would like you to meet them and spend some time with them. I think some of you know them already, but I would like to make the introductions anyway, and please say hello to the two new members. We have added Bala Srinivasa as a partner. Bala has been involved with... Wow. Bala, you're popular. They're clapping even before you come up here. That's great. Bala has been involved with young technology companies for over 20 years. Bala was part of the management teams at two successful analytics startups. And his last company, Amber Research, was acquired by Moody's in 2013. Bala spent the first part of his career as an equity analyst in Silicon Valley, covering the software space during the dot-com boom and bust. But of course, I think he left being an analyst right after the bust, and I took over. I was an equity analyst after the bust, and I had to do the heavy lifting of justifying what has happened in the past. So between Bala and I, we have covered tech stocks in the US during very interesting times for a span of 10 years, I guess, before and after the bust. So can you come up here and at least show your face for the people that don't know you?
Thanks, Rajesh. Just wanted to say thank you for everybody for being here. And somebody asked me earlier today, was this your first week at Kalaari? So I said, well, Kalaari moves fast, but not that fast. So I've been here for the better part of this year. I've had a chance to meet some very exciting companies, and I really appreciate the opportunity to be part of this platform. It really means a lot to me, and hopefully I can contribute positively to all these fantastic entrepreneurs over here. And equally important, you know, all our peer VCs who are here, as well as our partners, it's very important that, to me, that we work in a very constructive way and with you guys to kind of build what's possible in India. And I'm really looking forward to that. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Bala. So last but not the least, we also elevated Sumit Jain to a partner at the firm. He's the first homegrown partner at Kalaari, and it's a proud moment for all of us at Kalaari. And we have seen him grow over the years into a terrific VC. Sumit has been with Kalaari for 7 years, 7+ years. And has worked with some of our key companies, including Snapdeal, Attero, Simply Learn. Recently, he led our investments into Superprofs, Vakil Search, Trip Hobo, and Industry Buying. Sumit, can you come and say a couple of words? He's not happy.
Hi, everyone. Thank you. I love you all. I love you too. So, well, I guess, you know, I've been around here, but, you know, more than a couple of people I met this evening said, really, you joined Kalaari in 2009? I said, yes, and I guess I haven't met you before, so here I am, and I'm going to come and see you at your office soon, but a nice of you all to come here, and please enjoy the evening.
Yeah, Sumit may look small, but pound for pound, he's the best VC we have in the firm. All right. He may look young, but yeah. That wraps up the introductions. I won't take too much of your time. I think the evening is meant to be enjoyed, meeting people that you rarely meet. Please enjoy the evening. We have one important session. And I will ask Vani to come up here and take over. Thank you all.
You know, I want to take a moment and first share a few thoughts of the journey over the last 9 years. As most of you know, we just raised our third fund. That's not big news by itself, because now the real work starts. And you know, we are like all the entrepreneurs, the VCs, and you know, industry experts that are here, we all know that the real work starts from not raising of a fund, but in what you do with that and how you create impact with that. And it's not a solo journey by any means. Without the great entrepreneurs who build the value, without our co-investors who work with us shoulder to shoulder on all the boards and help build the value, we couldn't be where we are. And each of you have contributed to Kalaari's success over the last 9 years, whether we are number one of the number three or one of the number whatever, who's counting, but we couldn't be wherever we are without your support and help. And I'm deeply grateful. When we came here in 2006, didn't know anything in Bangalore and didn't really know where the industry was going to go. And we have been guided, helped, and supported by each of you. And thank you for that. And let's continue to collaborate and make great things happen in India. When we think about impact, when we think about creativity, when we think about change, we really think about the people in this room because we think of ourselves that way, either as entrepreneurs, as VCs, as tech. We have somewhat of a tunnel vision. It happens in Silicon Valley where I lived for too long and you think that's the world. And of course, we know that isn't. There is a world broader than that. But you know, we think of ourselves as change makers and impact creators. And rarely do we think of people completely outside of our sphere who may share the same traits and who may share the same outcomes, maybe even a far bigger platform and far bigger impact. It's my pleasure today to introduce Mr. KTR, and since this is an informal evening and he's himself a very informal person, I think it would be okay to call him Ram. He's the IT and Panchayat Raj Minister for the youngest state of India, Telangana government. And you may wonder, what has he got to do with all of us here? And when you hear him, I think you'll fully understand why this platform couldn't be better justified by having a speaker like us. And as each of us are building or involved in building great businesses, we know that nothing of impact can be simply created out of a private enterprise. And a public-private collaboration becomes extremely, extremely important to build any ecosystem when it's nascent and for it to thrive and survive. And I don't want to steal his thunder, but I want to share a few personal opinions and impressions. I haven't met It's not like I've met too many people in the government, but you know, we have a perception which all of the myths and stereotypes are broken when you meet Ram. I think he's young, he's dynamic, he has an MBA, all the things we don't necessarily attribute. He's innovative, forward thinker. He responds faster to emails than we do, and you know, that counts in our world. You know, and all the great things that I think he's going to put Telangana state on the map, Hyderabad on the map, and he has something very dynamic that he's doing with our industry, which each of us need to be aware. And with that, I want to thank and welcome Ram, who has taken his personal time to be here today with us.
Firstly, good evening. I'd like to thank Vani for the opportunity. Really appreciate this because this is the kind of audience that I typically don't get to meet. And as she has put it, it's easy being a politician, you know, because these days the standards aren't very high. So to impress Vani and the rest of you, I think all I need to do is probably speak a few sentences coherently in English. I think you'd be impressed. Because I remember the day when I was in the US and we had at a presidential election, we were witnessing a presidential election underway. We had George W. versus, I think it was Al Gore. And George W. came in with probably, I think most of us in the hall here would concur, probably the least expectation of a politician. So all he had to do was spell his name right and people were mighty impressed. So my mantra in politics today is basically increasing success by lowering expectations. That's what Indian politicians do. So once again, good evening. Just wanted to thank all of you once again. I represent the youngest state in India today. I call it the startup state, by the way, for those of you, you know, in the startup world. Because we came into being about 15 months back. And we came into being amidst a lot of confusion, amidst a lot of apprehension, a lot of prejudices, a lot of preconceived notions, etc., etc. For those of you who have a Hyderabad connect or Andhra Pradesh or Telangana connect, I think you would empathize. Lot of doomsday predictions that once Telangana was formed, once Telangana would be formed, you know, Hyderabad would go to dogs, Telangana would be, you know, misruled, misadministered, there would be bloodshed, etc., etc. But I'm glad to report none of that has actually come true, so very happy about that. In the last 15 months after we assumed office, the first and foremost thing we did was basically took stock of the situation, you know, be it IT or other sectors in Telangana. In fact, a lot of people ask me, IT and Panchayati Raj, these are two ends of the spectrum. One talks and caters to the rural needs and, you know, the poorest of the lot in India. The other talks about, you know, the upward swinging, you know, popular, really elite, so-called elite in India. So a lot of people ask me, how do you, you know, marry the two and bring about a great convergence? I think in today's world, where technology is all pervasive, where IT is, you know, undeniably permeating into every sphere of life, I think it's a matter of fact that every single department, every single person today in India is one way or the other affected by technology. So the day we took office, we assumed office, we basically took stock of the situation, and more so, the biggest concern, in fact, I must share this with you, the biggest concern and the biggest question I had in mind when we assumed office on day one was, how come Bangalore, you know, does so well in IT, and how come Hyderabad is a, you know, a distant second? Because the day we assumed office, Hyderabad's IT exports stood at 57,000 crores per annum, whereas Bangalore was almost three times that. So naturally, the question that came to my mind was, what does Bangalore do so differently? What is the X factor in Bangalore, which is lacking in Hyderabad? We started out our conversation with that. Talked to a lot of people in Hyderabad, talked to a lot of people, a lot of friends in Bangalore, you know, tried to get some answers. I was told several things, but the top three things that I was told primarily. One, Hyderabad, unfortunately, I was told, lacks an environment which cherishes, which nurtures innovation and research. Two, I was told, Hyderabad also does not produce, while it does produce a great number of engineers every year, we have, I think, 100,000 graduates every single year coming out of Hyderabad and the Telangana engineering colleges. Not a lot of them are readily employable, is what I was told. And number three, I was told also, Bangalore apparently has a lot better weather than Hyderabad, is what I was told also. See, the weather thing, obviously, it'll take a bit of time. So we figured, you know, we'll work on the other two. So we started off, and we started off in the right earnest. Day two of assuming office, I was in the Indian School of Business, one of the premier business schools in the country. We had a fantastic meeting with the dean there, Mr. Rajit Rangnekar. We started discussing, because even they had an incubator which was up and running. And we started discussing on what we can do differently in Hyderabad. What Ajit told me, with a lot of skepticism that day, was that, you know, firstly, I think you need to get your house in order, instill confidence in the investors here, try to ensure that the guys who've already set shop here don't run away to Bangalore or Chennai or Pune or Ahmedabad or Gurgaon. And he said, then we'll talk 10 days later. So we started off. We went back to the drawing board. We said, okay, how do we inspire confidence in the investors who have already set shop in Hyderabad? The first thing I was told also, again, TRS, the party that I represent, Telangana Rashtra Samiti, was the champion of the cause of Telangana. So we fought really hard. Sometimes the agitation really did, you know, probably hurt the business interest a bit also. But incidentally, I must share a fact with you here. During the peak of this agitation, back in 2009, I read a Facebook message from one of the Infosys employees, which said that Mr. Narayan Murthy, apparently in an internal meeting at Infosys, had commented that in spite of the agitation in Telangana, Infosys there in Hyderabad never had a down day. I did not believe it. Therefore, I did not actually share it with anybody. But I met Mr. Murthy recently, about 6 months ago, for the first time in my life. And he said the same exact thing to me. He said, even at the peak of agitation in Telangana, Infosys never had a single down day. Whereas in the same time, in the same 4 year span, in Bangalore, Infosys had about four down days because of one bund or another on Kaveri or some other issue. So while we were taking stock of the situation, we realized that things were not as bad as they were projected to be. So the first thing we had to do was dispel these myths and dispel these apprehensions. So we started reaching out, we started meeting out a lot of people, and as a consequence in the last 1 year, because of the outreach program the government has launched, I'm happy to share with you that we got three marquee names in IT to Hyderabad: Google, Amazon, and Uber. All three marquee names in IT have now decided to set shop in Hyderabad. Their largest campus outside of the United States will be in Hyderabad. Google is building almost 2 million SFT. Amazon is building about 2.5 million. And Uber is setting up their largest campus in Hyderabad also. In the last 1 year, not just Google and Amazon and Uber, we also focused excessively on bringing in more and more hardware and ESDM guys to Hyderabad also. As a result, today, We have Micromax Manufacturing, which has started out of Hyderabad again, Celcon, and also Thomson, which came back to India, the brand you know that was popular in the late 90s. Today, therefore, what we are trying to create in Hyderabad, besides the existing IT-enabled services business, we're also trying to bring in more and more hardware players, more and more manufacturing, so that it creates blue-collar jobs. Now, having done all this, we started thinking, where did we miss out? Where did we lose out to Bangalore? Apparently, the myth, the urban legend that goes around in Hyderabad is that when Texas Instruments came to India, their first stop was Hyderabad. This was back in 91, 92. Apparently, the then Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh was a gentleman who was about 80 plus, so he did not know who Texas Instruments was. He merely greeted them, you know, offered them chai, coffee, whatever, sent them away. The next stop was Bangalore. Apparently, they gave them something else here, and Bangalore gets Texas Instruments, and then the story goes they got Intel, and then, you know, they just gained the first mover advantage. By the time Chandrababu Naidu and others came around, by the time Ravi Venkatesan and Srini Kopolu were all working at Microsoft, and by the time the then government actually decided to take matters into its own hands and be proactive, it was a bit late. I think we already had Bangalore a head start, handed Bangalore a head start of about 7 to 8 years. So eventually we got Microsoft in the story, then the momentum built on. But in the last few years, we definitely lost out on a bit of the momentum. When there was a huge wave to be ridden, unfortunately, because of the apprehensions, because of the various factors, we did lose out on a bit of a momentum. So we did not want to lose out on the second wave of the possible growth that is likely to come. Now, I would have been happy if somebody like Vani would have guided us back in 2005, saying, you know, this is the place to be, this is the time to invest, etc., etc. But unfortunately, we didn't have anybody in Hyderabad doing that. But nevertheless, we started out about 6 months back, conceptualizing the country's largest technology incubator facilitated by a government. It's called the T-Hub. T-Hub basically is a plug-and-play facility created by government of Telangana. It is in the campus of the IIIT Hyderabad. It's a marriage of three interesting institutions. The Indian School of Business, like I said, which is one of the premier schools, will be doing the business mentorship. The IIIT Hyderabad and IIT Hyderabad will be doing technology mentorship. And then you have Nalsar, which is one of the best law schools in the country, doing legal and IP handholding. Government is merely playing a facilitator's role. I'm a strong believer in the theory that government should not poke its nose where it doesn't belong. I've lived in the United States for about 8 years, and I had only been to one government office in the entire 8 long years, and that was to a DMV office to get my license. So I think eventually, if India really has to get to a stage where inventions, discoveries, breakthroughs, and real tech companies, which will be talked about for ages to come, if they have to come through from India, I think government just has to play a facilitator's role and ensure all of you sitting in this hall here, in this garden here, actually come together, create that conducive environment so that you come together, talk to each other, collaborate, and create value out of this free market. I'm a very, very strong believer in that. Therefore, what we've done is we've reached out to Mr. Ratan Tata, we've reached out to Mr. Narayan Murthy, Mr. BVR Mohan Reddy, and a lot of others, Mr. Gurnani, etc., and we now have an arrangement in place where a 60,000 square foot facility, which was to be inaugurated last week by Mr. Tata himself. The reason why we chose Mr. Ratan Tata, in fact, let me quickly dwell on that and then move on. The reason why we chose Mr. Ratan Tata to inaugurate the country's largest technology incubator is because I believe he symbolizes the change, the transformation that is sweeping our country today. Tatas in our country have been known traditionally, have been associated traditionally with, you know, manufacturing, steel, you know, the good old define, design, deliver mantra that, you know, the manufacturing world talks about. They're not associated with the new age technology. But now this man, who's been the chairman for a while, he starts investing. Every other day we see him in the newspapers investing in Xiaomi, investing in, you know, one company, one startup or the other. So I wanted Mr. Tata to come inaugurate, because this T-Hub shall represent the change that's sweeping the country today. Because each and every time, I've been away from the technology world for the last 9 years, each and every time I see a valuation, I asked Vani this question this afternoon.
I asked her if the valuations weren't, a little overrated and, sometimes a little overplayed. She kind of, agreed partly. But I'm confused most of the time. When I see WhatsApp getting valuated at $19 billion, I'm confused. While I'm confused, I'm 40 by the way, while I'm confused, the youngsters in this country are enthused, they're kicked. They believe, they've started believing that they could be from anywhere. They could be from Odisha, they could be from Telangana, they could be from Bangalore, they could be from wherever. Technology now provides them the platform, the level playing field. Irrespective of where they are, they could dabble in innovation, provided a platform is given to them. They can come out with the next big thing in the world is the belief of young Indians today. I think that's the story that we want to build on. That's the audience that we would like to cater to. This T-Hub that we are talking about is not mere platform for some kid in Hyderabad or some kid in rural Telangana. This shall be a platform for the young Indians, irrespective of which location they currently reside in. We want to provide this platform for anybody who has an idea to be able to walk in with an idea and walk out with a product. So the entire journey, in the sense from an ideation stage to a go-to-market product stage, has been factored in. We also have created an innovation fund, and we are requesting a lot of these, a lot of you venture capitalists out here also, to discuss with us, to talk to us, in wanting to participate in this. In fact, I had requested Vani this afternoon also to have Kalaari take a look at this opportunity. Government is probably going to invest a bit of money, but we are also talking to a lot of fund managers. We are talking to some VCs in the US, in Silicon Valley and elsewhere as well, and we are wanting associations with them as well. Eventually, the goal of T-Hub is very straightforward. We want the next big breakthrough in India to come from Telangana and Hyderabad. We want Hyderabad to be the startup capital of this country. That's a far-fetched dream right now, I know, because I'm sitting in Bangalore. You're all looking at me, giving me the cold stare. That's all right, I can take it. But end of the day, I think 5 years from now, probably I would hope most of you would move to Hyderabad, hopefully. I've been asking Vani to move there, but hopefully most of you would move, and hopefully we'll create one of the best ecosystems in the country, because nowhere in India, in the 29 states that we have today, is a government trying to do something to facilitate, the youngsters of this country in giving aspirations, in giving wings to their dreams. The other two or three things that we're also doing, by the way, we're also building on other, other ideas, other new up and coming sectors, such as data analytics, cybersecurity, such as gaming. We are building up facilities once again, because we don't want to miss out on another wave of growth. I think Bangalore weather doesn't like me very much, speaking, nasty about Bangalore, but nevertheless, I'll conclude in a minute. So intent of the government of Telangana is very clear. We want Hyderabad ecosystem to be able to support any youngster who has an idea to come in and dabble. The most gratifying moment in the last 12 months for me, after having started talking about T-Hub, has come last week. A 12th grade kid from one of the public schools in Hyderabad sends me an email saying, my name is Ankit, I'm a 12th grade student at Chirag Public School. I have a fantastic application which I think you should, experiment, which I think you should support. So he comes to me the next day, presents it to me along with a couple of his friends, all of them in their school uniform. I thought, irrespective of how meritorious the idea was, I thought that movement itself was fantastic. It was one of those really gratifying moments. So this aspirations of young Indians, which I think we all need to sit up and take notice, which the world definitely in days to come will sit up and take notice, is something that we are trying to promote. I request you all to also work with us in this growth story, because the new government of Telangana, the mantra that we believe in is innovate, incubate, and incorporate. So for those of you who are interested in working with us, I welcome you all. For those of you who are wanting to stay put in Bangalore, good luck with the infrastructure and power cuts. Thank you so much.
Both because I'm older than him, and also considering this a beginning of a long-term friendship, I'll call you Ram and not Mr. Ram or Mr. KTR. Thank you for coming here today.
Thank you so much.
And as a gesture of thank you from Kalaari, the time you have taken and the inspiration you have offered all of us here. And I'm sure all of you will agree that this was dynamic and worth all of your time.
She's making me a partner in Kalaari now.
As long as you make me a partner in your cabinet, okay? So,
sure.
So we want to offer, thank you. It's just a donation on our behalf to Spurti, which is working with young children in Hyderabad.
Thank you.
So. Want to introduce my partner Kumar. Kumar and I, as you most of you know, have worked together for many, many long years from the very beginning of my coming back to India. And welcome, Kumar.
Hello, good evening. I hope you all are enjoying the beautiful Bangalore weather before it moves off to Hyderabad. Anyway, thanks. So my job is really easy. All I have to say is thank you to all. I know we all meet under difficult circumstances at times, hurried circumstances, board meetings, intense situations. So here is a day for all of us to just relax, have a drink. And my job is really easy to thank you all for coming. You know, you made our day. Now, Rajesh gave me full 5 minutes and I asked him, what do I say beyond thank you? Then he said, you know, you have to be there 5 minutes. So I said, okay, can I tell some jokes? Then he said, yeah, go ahead. We were planning to bring a band. It didn't work out. So he said, yeah, you can tell jokes. So long as the jokes are not on him, he's okay. But most of my jokes I know are about him. So it's kind of hard to come up with a joke, anything beyond that. So I figured I'll give you a piece of information which many of you could use. I think it also talks about the growth of digital India. And I think many of you could use this, I won't say suggestion, but information. Now, recently I was traveling in a remote part of Karnataka in a small village, and you know, there was a clinic there, and you know, I saw that in the clinic there were, you know, the sign was there, you know, the gentleman treats, I think gentleman, but you know, he treats neural disorders, piles, you know, all kinds of things. And in the end, there was one thing which I couldn't really easily read because it was in Kannada. And then he said, Wasapi something, right? Then I deciphered it. It turns out to be WhatsApp addiction. So in a small village, they do treat, in addition to all these other syndromes, WhatsApp addiction and Facebook addiction. So, and you know, even when I notice around here, a lot of people have that addiction. So, you know, maybe I'm going to try him out or the place out. And if it works out, I'm going to share that information with you so some of you can use it. But it shows how digital is pervasive all over the country and why the company is valued so well. Yeah, I'll share it on WhatsApp too. So. Anyway, so thank you all for coming. I think, you know, food is ready. So, you know, please enjoy the rest of the day. I hope you're having a good time and you continue to have it. Thanks a lot.